cayendo en una rajo.
No, no, lo que sucede es que como el Collin es un poco de
buenos días. Gracias a todos por acompañarnos. Es un gusto tenerlos aquí. Vamos a iniciar con la sesión que corresponde al Seminario de Instituciones, Sociedad Civil y Políticas Públicas con el tema Contribución de las Ciencias Sociales al Desarrollo. Nos acompañan en la mesa el doctor Edwin Brett, de London School of Economics, del Reino Unido, la doctora Alicia Ziccardi, de la UNAM, el doctor Collin Lewis, también de la London School of Economics, y el doctor Rafael Loyola, también de la UNAM. La mecánica que vamos a seguir es la presentación de los panelistas y después vamos a dar pie a la sesión de comentarios y finalmente una sesión de preguntas y respuestas. Para los panelistas hay un tiempo de 50 minutos previstos, unos minutos antes de que concluya. Les vamos a avisar que les quedan 5 minutos. La tarjeta roja es para advertirles que les queda 1 minuto para que nos hagan favor de concluir su intervención. Vamos a iniciar con la ponencia del doctor Edwin Brett. Él es investigador senior asociado, director del programa Desarrollo Administrativo, profesor visitante de la Universidad de Witwatersrand, Johannesburgo, Sudáfrica. Tiene experiencia en medios como televisión y radio, ha dictado conferencias en las más prestigiosas universidades alrededor del mundo. Es muy bien conocido por su trabajo en la economía política del desarrollo, la economía, las instituciones económicas mundiales y financieras, las políticas de desarrollo y administración para el desarrollo en países en desarrollo. Sus líneas de investigación o principales campos temáticos son la economía política del desarrollo, la reforma institucional y organizacional, problemas de crisis y reconstrucción institucional, y en términos geográficos es África, especialmente Uganda, Zimbabue y Sudáfrica. El doctor Brett fue ganador en 1991 del Consejo Asesor para la Investigación Científica en Problemas del Desarrollo de Holanda. Se asoció con al Instituto de Estudios del Desarrollo en 1993, siendo reconocido como asociado del Instituto de Estudios del Desarrollo en la Universidad de Sussex en los últimos 5 años. Anteriormente fue miembro distinguido de la de Ciencia Política en la Universidad de Sussex y un nivel superior de EREU, Estados Unidos. Es Ciencia Política de la London School of Economics desde 1966.
Sus principales publicaciones son el colonialismo y subdesarrollo en África del Este de 1973, Crisis Capitalista y Dinero Internacional de 83, La Economía Mundial desde la Guerra en 1985, proporcionando hacia la pobreza rural un análisis de la declinación de instituciones y la transformación
en Uganda en 1993. La participación y rendición de cuentas en la Administración del Desarrollo de 2003. La teoría del desarrollo en la era postsocialista. Alternativas de capitalismo y emancipación. Entendiendo las organizaciones y las instituciones en 1999, es un artículo de la revista Administración del Desarrollo. Respondiendo a la pobreza en Uganda, estructuras políticas y prospectos, es un artículo de 1998, y agencias voluntarias como organizaciones del desarrollo, teorizando el problema de la eficiencia y la rendición de cuentas de 1993. El tema que él nos presenta es sí, es el tuyo, el cambio. Este. Es historia económica y historia de empresa. Ah, este, perdón. Enfrentando la teoría del desarrollo del estructuralismo, desde el estructuralismo y neoliberalismo al pluralismo institucional. Le cedo la palabra al doctor.
Good morning. I'd like to thank the organizers for bringing me all this way to talk to you. This is only my second visit to Latin America after a very long life, and it's a great pleasure to be here. What I'm talking about today is the development of what I've called development theory, and what I'm trying to show, I suppose, is that development theory has actually been a serious intellectual and indeed practical enterprise, not just for the last 50 or 60 years, as is often assumed, but for the last 200 or more years. That development theory has had a particular role to play in the evolution of the institutions of modern democracy and modern capitalism. I should, I think, really have put those two the other way around, that is to say, the institutions of modern capitalism, which were created on the whole before the institutions of modern democracy. I think it is also fair to say that over the past 20 years, there's been the assumption that development theory was in crisis. There were very major thinkers in the 1980s talking about the impasse in development theory. There was an assumption that development theory no longer existed as a viable intellectual enterprise that was going to provide people in less developed countries, pre-modern countries, whatever term you like to use, with a way forward. What I would like to do today, and I have very little time, so I'll have to do it very quickly and in a very schematic way, is to try to, in effect, reinstate development theory by not only giving you a sense of the way it's developed and the different focuses that have occurred within it, but also giving you a sense of its important practical role. One of the critical things about development theory is that it has always been a policy-oriented discipline, a prescriptive discipline, because development theory is a theory about progress. It is a theory about how to organize social progress, and very clearly, any theory about how to organize social progress has no value at all if it isn't something that then gets translated into practice. So development theory has always had a very powerful political and practical role because it has always been about how to manage social change. I like to do this by starting by making a distinction between development and orthodox theory. Development theory, development studies, is part of the social sciences. The interesting question is, why do we need something called development studies rather than simply the social sciences? Why do we need a distinct body of ideas to deal with the particular problems that have been developed, have been identified as problems of development, as opposed to problems of running already developed societies? And I've specified this as needing to understand the difference between what I call development theory and what I call orthodox theory. And I define development theory as the study of institutional transformations in latecomers. By latecomers, I mean states that have come late to the processes of modern social transformation, the countries that lag behind. And I see development theory as the body of theory that is used by latecomers to manage processes of catching up with already advanced countries. And I identify orthodoxy as the theory of institutional maintenance and incremental change in already developed economic systems. It is that body of theory and assumptions about how to run the organizations of the modern liberal democratic capitalist state. The theory is about parliamentary democracy, about competitive economic markets, and so on. Now, both of these bodies of theory are concerned with progress. The orthodox social sciences are also social sciences about social change and progress. Developed countries also think of themselves, already developed countries, don't think of themselves as having got somewhere and are not developing any further. They are also committed to the idea of progress. But the difference between these advanced countries and less developed countries is that in developed countries, the countries that are operating on what I call the developmental frontier, that is to say, the countries that are operating with, that have already internalized and organized best practice, best institutional practice, these countries' progress is not something that is managed and centrally controlled. Progress is seen as the necessary outcome of the normal operation of existing institutions. So we have competitive economic markets in developed countries in order to push forward economic growth. We have developed democratic markets, competition between parties, in order to ensure that the people in power are constantly trying to maximize welfare. We have open civic institutions and social institutions, and indeed academic institutions, to maximize innovation, to maximize creativity. All of these things are institutionalized. So in these contexts, development is seen as a necessary outcome of the way the existing institutions already operate. The difference between these countries and less developed countries is that in less developed countries, the institutional arrangements that already exist have not yet internalized these capacities to create, let's call it, continuous innovation. If we think about countries that have authoritarian regimes, that have command economies, or have autarkic subsistence-based economies that operate under old-style patriarchal gender relations, that operate on the basis of theocracy, that impose central pressures on people. If we think about slave societies and feudal societies, The institutions in these societies are in fact designed not to maximize progress, but to minimize it. These institutions are designed to keep privileged elites in power and to block out the possibility of a generalized progress in the form of greater freedom and greater economic competence and individual independence. So what we have had, and indeed still have, is a world in which we have societies that are operating on the developmental frontier, and we have others, and indeed some of those others are now actually in worse situations than they were 20 or 30 years ago. If we think about Somalia, if we think about the Democratic Republic of the Congo, if we think, if I may say so, of Iraq and Afghanistan, we can see that we have countries in which the institutional arrangements that did exist were actually there to block development. These countries have existed in a world in which their people, and indeed outsiders interested in those countries, have recognized that there were these possibilities for progress. And the issue that they confronted was how to make that jump, how to make that change. And what we can see when we lay the argument out in this way is that development theory has to incorporate the understandings and visions of orthodox theory, because we are all looking for a picture of our own future. We are looking for a future that is better than the present. And if we live in a world in which we know that there are people in some other society that are doing things better than we are, we can take that picture and we can bring it to our own country, and we have a much clearer idea about where our future might be. We don't do it uncritically. We don't anymore accept that that picture of a future is going to be imposed on us by colonialists, as it was in the 19th century. But we have a clear notion of something more, and we live in a world in which there are many people in our own society who are actually consciously trying to ensure that that doesn't happen. It is very important to recognize that not everybody in a less developed society will benefit from development. Saddam Hussein was very clear that he did not want a democratic society, and he was prepared to murder any number of people in order to stop that from happening. So if you think about development as creating democratic institutions and you live in Iraq, you have a serious problem. So development theory therefore has to grapple with that issue of how one makes this transformation. And that issue requires us to have models of possible different kinds of futures, and also mechanisms for bringing those futures into existence. Now, that then brings me to the issue of the more concrete question of the relationship between development theory as a form of theory about managing social institutional change, and orthodox theory, which in the current phase is now a theory about free markets principally. It is a theory about how to create spontaneous relationships between free individuals who will operate in a world in which they have no clear image of what the future should be. Because what they are doing is inventing that future now, and when you're trying to invent things, you do not know what the future could be. So we can only progress in that societies by allowing individuals to be free to spontaneously invent, to try ideas out, and it is that process that is generating the major transformations that are happening. When few Harvard students go and set up a little garage and start experimenting with a new kind of machine called a computer, how were they to know that they would create a wired world in which I can go into the room over there and send an email to my wife who will receive it in 5 seconds' time and know that I'm here in Mexico. All of that is something that has transformed, formed the world, created all sorts of structural changes, but nobody could anticipate it at the time. Nobody knew that those six people in that garage were going to produce this revolution. There are thousands of people in garages all over the world who are not doing that. So what development theory has then became was a theory about management, and it distinguished itself from orthodox theory as a theory of interventionism, a theory initially seen as state interventionism, in which nations would consciously set up states that would then organize a process of economic and social and political change that would bring development into existence. And so if we look back historically, we can make a distinction between development theory as what I call structuralism, that is to say, processes in which economic and social change is managed by governments, by conscious social intervention, as opposed to orthodoxy, which is essentially a theory about free markets. And we can also, if we look historically, see that structuralism emerged in two guises. I distinguish between left structuralism and right structuralism. Left structuralism, one identifies with the Marxist tradition, more especially with the Leninist tradition, because Marx was actually not a structuralist in the sense of believing in state intervention. It was Lenin, Trotsky, and Stalin who actually believed in state intervention to build a socialist state. But of course, we have more reformist versions of left structuralism, which were old-style social democracy, both in the West and in countries like Latin America, for example. As opposed to right-wing structuralism, which is basically the state being taken over by those who want to create a corporatist capitalist system, who want to create a capitalism and are prepared to suppress the working class in order to ensure that this happens. The best recent book about this, I'd suggest, is a book by Coley, who shows how South Korea represented a right-wing corporatist structuralism in which state intervention was being used to build a corporate capitalism on the basis of suppressing the rights of the working class and other groups. Now, if we look at the history, moving away from that basic sort of theoretical framework, we can identify two major periods. The first period is the 19th and first half of the 20th century, when development theory is actually the theory which is being used by the late Western European latecomers attempting to catch up with Britain. If you want the early texts, if you want clear texts that have the characteristics of development theory, read Hegel's Philosophy of History, written in 1822, and more especially read List's the Nation State, written in 1842, in which List sits down and says, we in Germany are a backward society compared with Britain. We would like to have a fully competitive market economy, but for as long as we are backward, we are going to have to use protection to protect ourselves against the British. Therefore, we have got, while we are developing, to operate structuralist programs based on state control. And of course, that process was an enormous success. Don't let anybody tell you that structuralism has been a failure. Germany, France, Spain, Italy, in the 19th century, more especially the United States, which was also an actively protectionist society right up until 1945, Japan, all of these countries operated right-wing or left-wing structuralist programs with enormous success. They caught up with Britain and in most cases, in fact, in Western Europe, actually went beyond Britain. In fact, that process only came to an end really at the end of the 1950s and into the 1960s because we had structuralism, left structuralism in Western Europe from 1945 until 1960 during the period of post-war reconstruction. And of course, we had the Soviet experience going on at the same time. But what I think you probably think of as development theory has been the body of theory that emerged after the 1940s and into the 1950s, which was essentially a response to decolonization. This is something that you experienced in Mexico in the 19th century, but for most of the Third World, decolonization and the need for governments that knew how to catch up and develop began critically in 1947 with the independence of South Asia, India, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, and of course into the 1950s in Africa and into the 1960s, by which time. Now, that strategy was also built around structuralism, in some cases like Kenya, for example, right-wing structuralism, in which a new elite took control over the state and used it to build a very top-down capitalism, left structuralism in countries like Tanzania, where they tried to build a much more bottom-up based interventionist process. And that process has had extremely mixed results. Many large failures. In the terms of numbers, more failures than successes, because Africa had 45 countries and virtually all of them failed. Many mixed outcomes. South Asia, for example, India would be very mixed kinds of outcomes. And a few very big successes. So again, structuralism in the post-war, post-colonial situation has had enormous successes, because I would classify South Korea and the other East Asian countries in that bag. But by the end of the 1970s, that model of structuralism was in deep crisis. It was in crisis for two reasons. On the one hand, the global economy had been in a period of rapid upswing and boom up to the end of the 1960s. Into the 1970s, we had a major downturn and a major debt crisis and a major downward pressure on foreign exchange rates, on foreign prices, commodity prices, and so on. But on the other hand, we also had what was very critical, which was a failure of state intervention. Old-style structuralism assumed that we could rely on nation states to operate in effective ways, not necessarily democratically, but at least to operate rational economic policies designed to maximize growth and not to maximize the benefits of the political elite that captured the state. And by the end of the 1970s, it was very clear that that was not the case in very many countries, and in particular in the weak countries, Central America, Africa, parts of Central Asia. We had total disastrous state failures, in which it was very clear that it was because the state had control over the economy that reactionary and backward economic policies had been put in place that had actually destroyed their own economies. The country I'm looking at now, Zimbabwe, has been doing this itself over the last 10 years. Over the last 10 years, the Zimbabwe state has managed to secure a cumulative 10% decline in gross national product every year. So that now the Zimbabwe economy is producing only 40% of